the Hearthstone Thailand Major. My name is TJ, and once again, I'm joined by Pathra. We have one match left to go today.
I know, last match of the day. Let's make it a good one.
Are you freaking pumped?
Yeah!
So I was expecting that reaction, but yeah, I'm pretty excited. We have a good matchup to come for the last match of the day. It's a double jacks. It's jackpot versus the one jack.
Wow.
So is he going to hit jackpot, or will the one jack prove that he's the one jack?
And if that ain't enough, they've both brought the same lineup.
It's almost identical.
More or less. Like, yeah. The same classes, at least.
Yeah.
We haven't really looked into... we didn't really have the time to look into each and every one, but...
They're both running a Temple Mage, they're both running Dragon Warrior, they're both running Token Druid, and they're both running a Hybrid Hunter.
Okay. Are these guys brothers?
Are they brothers?
Well, that would be weird if they're brothers.
From different countries. One of them is a local Thai player. I think that's Jackpot, but I got them mixed up, actually, because I was told three times, but they're both named Jack, so... yeah, there's the schedule for today. That's what we've been through today. This will be this is a round of 16 match, but this is the first round of 16 match that we broadcast today. The last match actually showed round of 16, but it was a round of 32 match.
Mm-hmm. So this one still says round of 32.
Does it? I think it's a round of, who knows? We're pretty far into the tournament. That's what I know.
Yeah.
And there we go. Yeah, that's correct. That is 100% correct.
Yeah.
So this is the first round of 16 upper bracket. So what this will mean is that the winner of this secures himself a spot in the round of 8 upper bracket, which means they're guaranteed top 8.
It's a really good spot.
Yeah. Actually, they're not guaranteed top 8, because if they lose, then they go down to the loser's round of 16. But it puts them in a really good spot. It means they have multiple chances to get into the top 8. It puts them all the way. If they win one more, then they guarantee themselves a spot in the top 8. So round of 4 winner's bracket guarantees you a spot in the top 8.
Yep.
But definitely a great spot for both these players. And playing a similar lineup, this is going to come a lot down to their ban strategy coming in.
I have a feeling they're going to be banning each other's hunters. But we'll see.
It's a possibility. I said it earlier, it's either that or they're going to ban out each other's warriors.
Mm-hmm.
It depends how comfortable they feel in a Dragon Warrior mirror, which Dragon Warrior, a lot of players say, is like one of the easier decks to pilot. The Dragon Warrior mirror is actually really tough.
Yeah, that's true.
Because you have like to be Hunter, super greedy.
I feel like Hunter does okay against the Dragon Warrior. It's mm-hmm. like 50-50. They're both mid-rangey, tempo-y decks. Mm-hmm. It's just all about putting out the minions.
Call of the Wild is really... Yeah. Call of the Wild and Savannah Hyman are really tough for Dragon Warriors.
Actually, that's true.
But Dragon Warriors usually have a better...
Start.
Start, so depends. So actually, they both went with different bands. So we're both right. The one jack banned away Jackpot's warrior, and Jackpot banned away the one jack's hunter.
So we're not going to see the hunter on the one jack?
So I was right. The one jack is a Singaporean player playing for Gameforge, which is a Singaporean team. One of the three teams that has many representatives here. Gameforge, Abyssus, and Mana Surge are the three Singaporean teams that have a lot of representation at the Thailand Major. Had a lot of representation, or at least Abyssus and Mana Surge had a lot of representation at the Singapore Major as well.
This is the one Jack. First time seeing him.
Pretty young
guy. Yeah, I was about to say, he looks very young. And this is
Jackpot. Mr. Greedy! Love that shirt.
I used to read those books. They're the best. Mr. Men. Oh, he's got Playboy glasses.
He does. that's Jackpot, local Thai player. So we've had a lot of Thai players featured on our stream because, of course, we are in Thailand. Majority of the players here are Thai, actually.
Half of them, at least.
Yeah. So, yeah. Somewhere around there.
And it's actually really nice to hear the crowd outside go wild when they cheer on for their local men.
Yeah, as soon as one of the local players plays a Yogg, everybody just goes nuts. It's kind of crazy.
That's what I look forward to also.
Yeah.
Because it's not me playing.
If I was playing, there's been some Yoggs today where I would have tilted off the face of the earth.
Flipped the table?
Yeah.
Yeah.
But looking at their deck list a little bit more in depth, The Jackpot is running a Temple Mage with double Babbling Book and single Cabal's Tone, which we've actually seen struggle a bit today.
Yeah, I mean, the tomes just tend to sit in their hand.
Or they just don't get good cards.
Yeah.
I mean, it's one of the things about running tome. I think Babbling Book has a little bit more of a place in Temple Mage right now because the 1-1 body is actually relevant.
I agree.
In a lot of situations. Because it allows you to hold on to some of your 2-drops and you can use like Ping plus the Babbling Book body to trade in into like a 3-2 on turn 2 instead of having to rely on like a 2-drop or a spell. So it opens up a lot of flexibility. But Cabal's Tome, especially, it seems like a lot of players are bringing very fast-paced decks here. There's more hunters than normal. There's a lot more other Temple Mage mirrors than normal that are running faster versions of Temple Mage. A lot of Shamans, of course. A lot of Dragon Warriors. So it feels like in a fast-paced environment, Cabal's Tome is just a little too slow.
I feel like that's just a very Asian thing. Like, we're just known for always playing aggro a lot, not a lot of control.
Yeah.
You've noticed that, too.
China's like the worst culprit of that, though. Chinese decks are very aggressive.
Really?
Very aggressive.
Like, what do they run normally? Like, what makes a deck very aggressive?
Like, Temple Mage, just like a very low curve. They were sort of the first players to run like the 8-1 drops with double Arcane Missiles, double Arcane Blast, double Mirror Image, double Mana Worm. They were using like Arcane Explosions and Blood Mage Thaunos to like keep their early aggressive boards alive against other aggressive decks.
Yeah, that sounds intense.
Yeah. So jumping into game number one here, the final match of the day, the One Jack versus Jackpot, and it's Hunter versus Warrior. These are the two decks that they decided to ban away from their opponent. So, interesting start.
It's great, actually. Like I said earlier, it's pretty much 50-50, but it's looking like not the best start for Dragon Warrior, but yeah, we got the turn two, but there's nothing else to follow. Hopefully, he can probably top deck something. And I feel like the One Jack's hand is looking really good. So Jackpot has the option to trade into this and then like axe it down.
I think I like that.
Yeah. You really, it's all about claiming the board here. Whoever has the minions on the board is most likely going to win. And you want, as a Dragon Warrior, you want to have the board before Call of the Wild. And you want to be able, so you want to have a board so that when the hunter does put down the Savannah High Main, he's going to be trading. Right.
Yeah. Not going face, because that Savannah Hyman hits face, you probably lost.
What now?
So Jackpot has a full golden Dragon Warrior deck.
Actually, I was about to say that, I just forgot. It's very impressive.
You can tell he plays a lot of Dragon Warrior. I think this might be the first time I've seen a golden Dragon Head Crusher, even though it's a common. Mm-hmm. Not many people craft that sucker.
Yeah, actually, I've never seen it before. Until now. Oh, wow. Okay, so he has jugglers in his hunter. I wonder if he has the hyena?
Scavenging hyena?
Yeah. I'm not sure, but sometimes the hunter decks run that.
Yeah, there's been a few players today that have run it.
A weird turn for him. I feel like he probably should coin out the Infested Wolf, but then it's just gonna die.
Yeah. Well, he might be okay with that, because if he doesn't trade into it, it's actually pretty unlikely that he doesn't trade into it, but if he doesn't trade into it, it means that he can get the Knife Juggler value next turn. And I'm checking real quick to see if he does run the Scavenging Hyena, because that might change some things that we talk about within this matchup. It would mean he's sort of like all in on the Unleash the Hound synergy, which is okay.
Yeah.
One Jack actually runs secrets, so he's got quite a few secrets in here.
With the Huntress?
Oh my god, and an Azoth.
Oh, so this is a Azoth Hunter?
Yeah.
Oh, interesting. With a Juggler.
Yeah. So he has double Knife Juggler. Very high amount of secrets. 3, I think, with Cloaked Huntress. And not any extra Death Rattle minions. He just runs, you know, double High Main, double Grandmother, and double Infested Wolf. But he also has Barn. So if Barn pulls a Death Rattle, it actually summons an extra copy of it. So if Barn summons a Savannah High Main, and then you play a Savannah High Main later, and then play Nazoth, it'll summon back two full health Savannah High Mains.
Yeah, it's so dirty.
Just sort of an extra layer of insurance against control decks.
Yeah, so he's going to have to play the Animal Companion here. It's even though it's slightly off curve, it is the best minion for this turn.
Yeah.
Oh, this is nice.
This is going to be a lot of pressure.
Right, and Jack... Oh, okay. I can't just say Jack. The one Jack has to draw a kill command. That's like one of the only ways to deal with a Frothing Berserker.
Yeah.
Or he could play...
Juggler Unleashed could be dangerous because if one of the Juggles goes into the Frothing Berserker...
Right.
And like one of the Juggles goes face. So yeah, I like this play. Just play the Knife Juggler out.
He's definitely going to be playing around freezing though.
Yeah, but this is the situation that you want to be in. Like you talked about earlier, when your opponent plays a high main, you want them to have to trade. You don't want them to be in a situation where they can just hit face and pressure you.
Yep.
And as the warrior, you're basically in a situation where you want to win the game by like turn 7 before they can play Call of the Wild, because you really struggle to deal with Call of the Wild. And I don't know if Jackpot was able to put on enough early pressure to deal with it, but he will be able to play a 9-9 yep. here and still have Alex Shaw's champion in his hand for a little bit of extra burst. So yep. might be able to actually end the game before Call of the Wild comes out. And it
exactly.
looks like that's going to be the case.
This is nuts. Like Corcoran and Alexstrasza. That's an extra 7 damage, and it looks like the Savannah High Main has to trade into. Actually, it's looking really bad. It's pretty much a done game.
He has to kill both the Dragonhead Crusher and the Frothing Berserker here, which is possible. I think you unleash first to see where the Juggles land.
I feel like he has to. Yeah, trade into it first though, right? You can see where the Juggles land, I guess. Wow. Oh goodness.
He needs one of the Juggles to hit either the Frothing Berserker or the Dragonhead Crusher. Actually needs two of them to hit. And yeah, he's not gonna be able to clear both.
It's actually, oh wow. Okay, the Froth, that's pretty much a done game.
Yeah. Yeah, there's no way that he can clear enough damage off the board to survive, so Jackpot is going to take game one with the warrior. And in the battle of the non-banned decks, it seems like Jackpot made the right choice in not banning the hunter away, able to take a win. I think that the one Jack's hunter deck is a lot more inconsistent, mm-hmm. and that's why Jackpot didn't ban it away.
Yeah.
He probably would have banned Hunter in a normal situation, but I don't think he respected this list from the one Jack because it's very weird. Secrets are inconsistent. Mm-hmm. He's got like one ofs of Deadly Shot and one of Eagle Horn Bow and an Azoth. It just seems like there's a lot of dead draws.
Juggler.
Yeah.
It's just like a lot of, it's like a little bit of everything.
Yeah. Sometimes that's not good in Hearthstone.
Yeah. So I guess he was like, you know what? If he's top decking Secrets, I'm good.
Yeah, that's exactly what he's thinking. And Freezing Trap didn't really do much. Freezing Trap just sort of gave him more ammo. He already got the 3 damage with the Alex Shaw's champion. He got it back, which gave him another chance to possibly be able to use it later on. So now Jackpot with that 1 game lead, he's got Token Druid and Temple Mage left remaining. His Token Druid was a little weird too. It was Token Druid, but it had like a weird top end. It had double Moonglade Portal, I think, which is pretty unheard of for a Token Druid. A lot of times you run Ramp Druid with it because it's kind of, it can sometimes be a dead card early on. But I'm curious to see how this works because I really think that Moonglade Portal has a place in at least some competitive.
I feel like it's a good card. If he has the double War, it's great because like you can just heal up your Wars.
Yeah.
It's just hard for them to just keep trying to kill it and take it down.
It's also the only portal card that actually summons a minion of the same cost as the portal, which is really, of course, strong, because even if you paid 6 mana to summon a random 6-drop, that'd still be pretty good a lot of the time. The effect is just sort of a bonus.
Yeah.
Where if you look at, like, Ironforge Portal, you get the effect, but you're paying 1 more mana than the actual minions cost. Or Silver Moon Portal, you're paying 2 more mana than the actual minion cost. Firelands Portal, you're paying 2 more mana than the actual minion cost. So even though it has arguably the weakest effect of all the portals, the minion that you spawn is actually the same cost as the cost of a portal. So, just for pure efficiency, it's better than the other portals. Of course, Firelands is probably the best one, but...
You seem biased. Well, I don't know. I've played a lot of Moonglade, so I really like the Moonglade. I need to play more Firelands.
Firelands Portal is just really good.
Yeah, you get charged minions. Like,
there's 3 charge 5 drops. Yeah. Doomguard, Leroy Jenkins, and Tundra Rhino.
Tundra Rhino, 2 damage.
That's still pretty good.
Yeah. I mean, actually, any damage towards face is great. And then you just burst down there.
Yeah.
So this is going to be game number 2. And it's going to be the Tempo Mage versus the Tempo Mage.
All right, so these ones I pretty sure differ quite a bit. They don't really. They're actually very similar. So they both run Babbling Books.
Pretty much great hands on either side.
He's an all golden Tempo Mage too.
This guy, maybe he just buys a lot of cards.
Sure, yeah. Maybe he hit the jackpot.
Oh, so good. Good one.
It was really bad.
I know. But I like cheesy jokes. Is he actually? Okay. But he's got the, Frostbolt.
Can't quite trade into the Mana Worm.
I think he should just ignore it for now. Well, actually, he should trade so that he could ping it down later, because Jack is thinking, if Jackpot has something, at least I can ping it down later.
Yeah. Ooh. Babbling Books.
I like how they sound when you try and attack with them.
Oh, I don't even play with game sounds on. I don't even know how they sound when they attack.
Aw, you're missing out.
Well, I'm sure we'll get to hear it this game. I don't know, because they'll probably just get pinged off the board.
It just sounds like a crazy book.
Cabal's Tome from Babbling Book?
Wow.
It's infinite value.
It just keeps going.
But if that Cabal's Tome gets another Cabal's Tome.
Right. Ooh. I don't mind the Arcane Missiles. Or you could just Forgotten Torch down the Cult Sorcerer.
This is probably the best Arcane Missiles is going to get.
Right.
Whereas Arcane Blast, you have the spell power to make it better.
And I feel like you like to save the blast, the Arcane Blast, for like a Drake.
Mm-hmm.
And he's got the Thalnos in his hand ready for that.
So Arcane Missiles has a very good chance of clearing here. Just 2 out of 3 shots have to hit minions. Doesn't matter which minions.
Yeah.
So
it's just going to be bad if it goes face, though.
Well, but it won't be too bad. As long as one of the shots hits the Cold Sorcerer, it'd be really bad if 2 shots went face and 1 shot hit the Babbling Book. Be really, really bad if all 3 went to face. But at least you'd still be able to ping off. But he goes with the consistent play. I like this play also because a lot of times getting a Roaring Torch in your deck early is really good, because it gives you a better chance to draw it, of course. Because it's a higher chance to draw it if it's in your deck than if it's not in your deck at all. Then it's a 0% chance if it's not even in your deck.
Sometimes people just like to play the Forgotten Torch just because, like, it's on curve and it's just very hard to play later on.
Yeah.
Babbling Book against Babbling Book.
Arcane Explosion. It's not too bad.
Yeah, actually in a mirror match, I think that's actually pretty okay.
Yeah.
He's just going to play on curve and... is he going to Tome here or is he going to Drake?
Kind of like the Tome, just get it out of the way.
Yeah, it's probably going to be a long game. And he's got the Yogg, so he probably should feed the Yogg. Since it's in his hand.
Yeah. This matchup goes one of two ways. Either one player just blows out the other player with a crazy opening hand, or you play a very grindy game where both players end up expending all their spells or try and remove and go for burst, and then basically the first player to have, or the player that has a better Yogg wins. Which is a terrible way to decide games, but sometimes it's necessary.
This is going to be very easy for Jackpot to take out the Drake. And he saved the Arcane Blast just for this. Or, does he even want to do it?
This is the biggest min you're going to hit with that, I'm pretty sure.
Yeah.
So you might as well. Just developing Blood Mage down us, though, and pinging face isn't really like a good full use of your turn. So maybe if Jackpot feels like he can take an extra 4 damage and force him to have it, maybe. Looks like he's just going to try and be more mana efficient.
Right. It's not the greatest turn to just Thalnos and Arcane Blast. Ooh, Polymorph Boar. He's got his own Arcane Explosion. And a Frostball is always good. Another Frostball. It's very funny. Like, it's a very slow game for both sides. They know that, like, they're not really getting solid minions. They just have a ton of spells.
Yeah.
Yeah, so Jackpot is definitely going to hold on to the Arcane Explosion until the one Jack grows his board a bit more.
Yeah. It's really interesting. Neither player's wants to use key resources.
Mm-hmm.
Neither player wants to be the aggressor in the matchup.
They value all their spells a lot. It's always tough to fight in mirror matches. And I feel like I don't see Tempo Mage versus Tempo Mage a lot.
Usually one player is the aggressor and one player is sort of like the defender. And a lot of times the aggressor just wins because in this match, since neither player has minions, a lot of times it's just the first player to be able to, that can deal 30 damage to the face wins. Especially if players have very aggressively themed hands, if they have a lot of burn in their opening hand, they'll just go for it. And that can win games.
Firelance Portal to the face.
Ooh.
Oh, one of the worst ones, actually.
There are a lot of bad 5 drops.
Yeah, a lot of bad 5 drops.
Big Game Hunter. Faces Manipulator, Starving Buzzard, Ram Wrangler, Grim Patron.
Emperor Thorazin is actually great in a mirror matchup, in a Tempo Mage mirror matchup. Okay, both of them have their Yawks ready to go. He should kill the Emperor Thorazin, but he's gonna see what he gets first. Flame Lance, deal 8 damage to a minion.
That's kind of funny.
Does he want to use his Roaring Torch, though, or his Flame Lance on the Emperor Thorazin?
I kind of like missiles and try an Arcane Explosion. I don't know. Yeah.
Nice. It's going to go with just that.
Now you can Arcane Missiles. You get 4 shots, and just 2 of them have to hit the Emperor Thorazin, and he has 3 health. So I think it's pretty likely. Arcane Missiles is not getting any better.
Yeah.
He's going to go with the safe play.
Which is fine, too.
What
else was he going to use that on? And one Jack has the Arcane Explosion.
And Firelance Portal to the face!
Where shall I strike? Hey, that's not bad. Ooh, the Flame Waker. Here we go.
Time for some fireworks.
This is the first Flame Waker that we've seen. This is what they were waiting for.
Yeah.
All these spells in their hand and no Flame Waker yet. But yeah, here we go.
I think with this hand, you're just cashing in on the Arcane Missiles.
Yeah, they're just being...
Push an extra 6 damage. He's got a Roaring Torch in his hand. He's got 2 natural fireballs in his deck, I believe. So puts him down to 15 and all of a sudden solidifies himself as the aggressor. But the one Jack has decent answers to this and picks up Cabal's Tome. So many spells.
Yeah, this is going to be great. Let's see the spells.
Oh, another Cabal Stone? He's got a Cabal Stone from Babbling Book, then played a natural Cabal Stone, and then got another Cabal Stone from his Cabal Stone.
Yeah, that's nuts. But what's he going to do here? He could turn the Flamemaker into a boar.
He just Dragon's Breath it and leave the 0-2s up. I don't really see anything wrong with that, to be honest.
Yeah, that's a good play.
I mean, if Jackpot picks up more burn, then this game might be done pretty quickly. Flame Lance, unfortunately, not really the burn that he's looking for.
Yeah, I mean, he can't kill the Sorcerer's Apprentice unless he Flame Lances it, but it's not really a good... It's not really what you want to do.
Yeah, I mean, he's losing the resource battle, so Jackpot needs to try and make something happen. And
ouch.
Did he just run towards the Sorcerer's Apprentice?
Okay.
Glad that went face.
Yeah, he's got the spell damage, and he's got the Yogg. The one Jack is actually probably trying to look for an ice block here. Oh, he's got the ice barrier.
Counterspell and ice barrier, not bad. And he could do all that plus fireball, plus arcane blast.
Right. He's got, oh wow, just a ton of spells.
Yeah, and he's got a huge resource advantage with all these Cabal Stones that he's been able to cast. Mm-hmm. And Cabal Stones that he's been able to cast for cheaper as well.
I'm actually looking forward to their Yoggs.
I'm just a little bit frightened by the potential of these Yoggs, especially the one Jack, because he's cast a lot of spells this game.
Right? Probably he's got like 20.
He's got like 10 more in his hand.
Just fireball it and then put up the secrets.
Yeah, that's what I like.
He's got a babbling book to give him another spell.
All right, Jackpot. You know what time it is.
Here we go.
Well, the game's not over.
Let's make magic. He's growing his board.
Okay, drawn cards. Runic Egg, not the best.
Oh, that's actually... Oh.
Whirlwind, definitely not the best. Elemental Destruction, definitely not the best. This Yogg is bad.
Oh, no. Oh, no. Oh!
That was terrible.
Ouch.
Yogg, what are you doing?
It didn't seem like a lot of spells either.
Yeah. I mean, he didn't have Cabal's Tome.
It's like 7 spells or something?
Yeah. And now Jackpot's like, well, now that you're out of stuff, I'm just going to try and race you.
Yeah, you know, even though I'm 9 HP, and I can come back.
Oh, yeah. Turn that Babbling Book into 6 damage. Love it.
That Babbling Book definitely got some value.
He's going to snap call that Arcane Intellect and be very sad when his counterspell.
Oh. No. Got a Flame Lance first, maybe. Ouch.
Yep.
Or maybe it was just like, it's fine to keep the Flame Lance because it's a sure way to deal with the Flame Waker.
Yeah, but... I mean, this game's all but over for Jackpot. He needs to find exactly 2 pieces of burn while one Jack finds absolutely nothing. Which just doesn't feel like it's possible. I don't know.
Yeah. This was a really long game, actually. Who knew? Tempo Mage versus Tempo Mage.
Well, both players are playing Babbling Books and Cabal Stone. It becomes really grindy.
Yeah.
Is he actually going to kill the Runic Egg? There's no way. Okay. Whew. Good. But yeah, this game will be over next turn unless Jackpot finds a way to win or heal. And both of those... Or I guess he could kill the boar, but then he'd probably die to Yogg anyway. So it does pick up Fireball, though. But he can't win unless he Fireballs
the boar. That's crazy. Do you think the one Jack is going to play the Yawk? Or he wouldn't? Or do you think he will? It's actually really scary because you could kill yourself.
He's thinking about it.
Oh, wow.
And actually, I think it would be better if Jackpot pings his own Runic Ache that turn. Because then he gives himself two turns. He gives himself, he could win the next turn. Because next turn he could draw his natural draw.
Yeah.
And ping his Runic Ache again. So that way he gets two draws next turn to give himself two opportunities drawn to burn. Oh, wow.
Yuck. Vanish.
Well, all of his cards are green. So that means one player has won. We'll see exactly who that player is, but Forgotten Torch, if it goes to his own face.
Oh my
okay.
goodness.
Okay, swipe. Okay, he won.
Ah, wow. Oh my goodness. That was so scary. Would you do that?
Bold. That is very bold.
He got like three fireballs. So.
Yeah, I mean, he would have won the next turn anyway, but a couple of weird plays at the end of that series there. And I mean, to have that one come down to whether or not Yawk's spells goes to the one Jack's face or goes to Jackpot's face is a little bit bizarre of an ending for how grindy that game was, but he's going to tie up the series.
I feel like, yeah, Jackpot's Yawk was really bad.
It was very bad. It cleared all the minions and then only cast spells that affected minions.
Yeah.
Like Blessing of Might, Circle of Healing, just very bad stuff.
Unleash the Hounds.
Unleash the Hounds with zero minions on board. So, now both players have different decks out of the way. Jackpot won with the Dragon Warrior earlier. The one Jack just ran with Temple Mage, so...
tied for one.
Yeah.
I feel like this is going to be a very, very long one. Especially since it feels just like a ton of mirror matches.
Yeah. And, you know, that it's we haven't had that be the case very often today, but it was bound to happen eventually because there's a lot of players with this very similar lineup, maybe with Shaman instead of the Hunter. But a lot of players are bringing Toke Druid, a lot of players are bringing Dragon Warrior, a lot of players are bringing Temple Mage, and a lot of players are bringing sort of the Hybrid Hunter. Mm-hmm. The one Jack, though, is not really a Hybrid Hunter. I don't even know what to call it.
Yeah, I feel like that's usually... that's a great lineup, because I feel like Zoo isn't, like, that strong.
Zoo's not that good. I actually only like to run either Hunter or Temple Mage, and not both, and run a Shaman instead.
Yeah, I agree.
Like, I think Aggro Shaman instead of Temple Mage is pretty good. Or instead of the Hunter is pretty good. Depending on what you're trying to counter. Either way, you're trying to target Zoo in a way.
Yeah, you're not afraid of Zoo. Yeah. Definitely.
And so, in that case, I kind of like the Temple Mage better because I feel like Temple Mage is a little bit better spot against Zoo than, say, the Hybrid Hunter would be, even though it does have more early game now.
Yeah, and like the Dragon Warrior can take on Zeus, the Aggro Shaman can take on Zeus, so can the Midrange Shaman or the Totem Shaman.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
Game number three is about to start. I thought it was a not yet, I guess.
Yeah.
Oh, here we go. Let's see what they've picked. The one Jack with his Druid and Jackpot with his Tempo Mage again.
Okay, we'll see if you can pull out a win this time. But this is a token druid with, for the one Jack, just a pretty standard token druid. Double arcane giant, double ancient of war, wild teacher package, the whole shebang.
Just like Cenarius or Onyxia?
I don't think Cenarius or Onyxia.
None? Okay.
Just a very consistent early game, if I remember correctly. Like double Mire Keeper. The double three drop with one Feral Rage, one Mulch, so. Just a very consistent list. I like this one a lot.
I feel like, does Jackpot play his?
He's ping.
Yeah. I feel like if you just put down a minion, it's just gonna die.
Yeah.
Getting that ramp in so he can play his bigger minions. He could actually Arcane Blast this. play.
Question is it Arcane Blast with Cult Sorcerer or Arcane Blast with Flamewaker or Arcane Blast with Blood Mage? I think you can rule out Flamewaker because it is very risky. Mm-hmm. And you could just end up playing Flamewaker next turn with a Spellpower minion kept onto the board. Especially since Druids really want to nourish on turn 5.
We can put the Cult Sorcerer out and blast it and see if he has, like, the Wrath. Because if he just plays the Thalmos, it's just very easy to deal with. But then it stops him from nourishing, you know?
Interesting.
Kind of like the Blood Mage, because if he does nourish, then you keep a minion that otherwise... Well, if he nourishes for cards, but I think he's probably going to nourish... Well, I don't know. If you nourish for mana, it means you can play Ancient of War next turn. If you nourish for cards... I mean, you have, like, all the things in your hand that you need to actually win the game, really, with double Arcane Giant plus an Ancient of War.
I feel like Nourish for mana would be okay here.
Alright, he wants to play an Arcane Giant next turn, I feel.
And he's gonna cycle. Play on curve, that's pretty that's expected for the Azure Drake to come down.
Look at all that burn!
Yeah, that's a ton of damage. Okay, so he chooses to go with the Arcane Giant here. Not
this is just
war.
Gonna get answered.
Yeah, Frostbolt could actually. Or. There's a ton of things he could do, actually.
See how greedy he decides to be. If he goes for Cold Sorcerer Mirror Image, he gets heavily punished by Azure Drake Swipe. Sort of unlikely at this point. But I think if you're going to take a risk, this is going to be the turn to do it before they have a chance to draw into, like, the perfect answer. So I wouldn't mind seeing Cold Sorcerer and Mirror Image and just try and, you know, overload next, like, just go crazy next turn with all the spells.
It's a bit strange. He could just... Okay, so he's just going to... He's going to Frostbolt and Arcane Blast.
Interesting.
Okay. Oh, now he's gonna go for the gamble.
Yeah. It's not gonna kill it.
It gets down to one health, though. So he can just ping it off next turn. But Swipe could put an end to this.
Actually, yeah, he can clear the whole... He could clear both minions. Both Drake and Flamewaker.
We'd have to Swipe Mulch. But there's not really any other big minions that are going to make it through.
Swipe in Living Roots. Right, that's what you mean? Oh, sorry. That's not Spell Tapage.
I mean, technically he could. He could Living Roots one of the Mirror Image. And then Hero Power 1, and then trade the 8-1 into the Azure Drake.
Power of the Wild. It's a lot of spells, and like a lot of damage that he could go face with.
Yeah, so if he Cult Sorcerers and double Frostbolt, each Frostbolt will be 5, so he push 14 damage this turn. He put the one check down to 13 with the fireball in his hand, so it wouldn't be enough to go for lethal. So it looks like he's just going to go for value-ish trades here. So just trade over one of the 2-2s. Or he's actually going to trade to the 9-2 if he Arcane Intellects. Interesting.
Oh.
I guess he really wants that burn to go face. Or he's really worried about a big minion. And for good reason, too, because One Jack does have a big minion. with the Ancient of War.
He can actually kill. Yeah. Well, I was thinking Feral Rage could have killed it off.
Scary board. Still a way to answer it, though.
Drake is pretty good.
I think we can Babbling Book first here.
Yeah, I don't think maybe you can't play the Drake yet.
Babbling Book, Mana Worm, Fireball, Ping.
Or you play the Drake and just Frostbolt one. Frostbolt the Giant.
It's possible as well.
Just to stall it. And grow your Mana Worm.
Alright, Babbling Book, what do you got? Cabal's Home again? You gotta be kidding me with this.
I feel like we're gonna see like 10 tomes today, tonight.
That's crazy.
Let's make magic.
Okay, so he's gonna do what I sort of said, but without the trade. So it'd be called Sorcerer instead.
These missiles have a chance to almost not do anything.
Actually,
I mean,
killed off one.
Yeah, I guess that's a pretty good scenario for him.
Can he take down this war? I mean, yeah, he can, but it's not with the Drake.
Yeah, I think just Azure Drake, Frostbolt, and then play the Cult Sorcerer is going to be...
Yeah, kill the Arcane Giant.
Yeah.
Let's make magic!
Because then the one Jack's forced to trade into one of the minions, but not both. And either way, you can just Frostbolt to finish off. But, oh man, a swipe would just be absolutely brutal for Jackpot here.
This is okay also. Teacher into Raven Idol?
I think you really, if you get a swipe here, you are going to regret very heavily playing Violet Teacher.
Right, that's true.
We'll see what he picks up. Would have been an automatic swipe choice, so I think these are three either... Okay, Soul of the Forest, Mark of the Wild, and Claw are the three options. So yeah, those are all pretty bad. Claw lets you kill off the 3/2 this turn, which
Maybe
is pretty
Soul
good.
Soul of the Forest, I was thinking.
Yeah, Soul of the Forest allows you to, in a grindy battle like this, especially in combination with Violet Teacher. He's actually going to save both. Wow, okay. I thought he would at least play the Violet Teacher, so that way next turn he could play something else plus Soul of the Forest. Now he just might not have a board to play Soul of the Forest with.
Right. That's probably the case. Tome. Let's see what Jackpot is going to get.
Another tome.
Oh no.
Oh my goodness.
It's going to be, oh my god, a tome fiesta.
A tome fiesta. So, should be a way for Jackpot to clear the board here if he wants to use the arcane missiles.
I feel like he shouldn't. He just leaves it.
Well.
Oh, actually, he can hit into it. Yeah, and it's arcane missile. Wow, nearly.
Yeah.
Ooh. Ho-ho. Drop the teacher down. This is going to be good with the Soul of the Forest and the Panther.
He really wants to next turn Violet Teacher into Power of the Wild into Soul of the Forest.
Yeah, I think he should hold on to it. That's only because I can see the flame that's in his hand.
He really wants to go for that combo. Once you play that, you basically can't lose the game from there, I feel.
Yeah. It's actually what the old token druid used to have, right? And then they cut the Soul Forest.
Yeah. Because it's too slow against some of the faster decks out there. A lot of the times your board gets cleared, Soul Forest hits the dead card in your hand, so. All right.
Tome again?
Show me another tome.
Let's do it. It's probably the only way he can deal with the
Interesting.
Teacher.
Interesting.
And, all the tokens.
Okay, whew! Dodge the tome. Thank God.
You didn't want another tome.
No. At a certain point...
You just haven't. You just don't want it.
You're just all tomed out.
I feel like he needs to kill this Azurjig. With the, yeah, Flame Lance. Okay, I guess he wants to copy that minion.
I don't know how I feel about that.
Yeah, I don't like the Drake living.
Job done.
I don't like the Babbling Book Blast. But, whatever.
Actually, he could have played the Babbling Book, right? And then, all right. Frostbolt.
Yeah, games. Yeah. I think Vile Teacher Fandral Power of the Wild's better here.
Yeah, that's nuts.
No!
Copied the teacher.
Come on, One Jack, get greedy.
I guess he's worried about the Yogg, you know?
Yeah.
And he's just like, if he has Yogg, I want the Soulfire. I'm sorry, Soulfire. I want the Soul of the Forest.
Yeah.
Oh, another tome!
That one's actually in his deck, though.
I know. It's not over.
Yeah.
Many more, many more spells.
It's getting close to being over, though, because this board is really tough to deal with.
I feel like we have to kill this teacher.
Perhaps.
Deeb is unsure if he agrees with you or not.
I feel like he needs to kill the teacher and then use the Ice Lance. Cone of Cold, sorry. Just to, like, stall for a bit. I could clear the 1/1 with his Babbling Book. I feel like it's just really tough when you have many, many options.
Yeah.
Ooh, Firelands Portal. Yeah, this is good. Getting rid of the spell damage.
I don't know, he didn't really... He took a lot of power off the board, but...
So the Fandral's just going to sit in his hand.
I guess so.
I like the Flame Waker, though, because it can deal with a bunch of these things. So Flame Waker, Cone of Cold, and a spell? A secret? I think I'm getting tired.
Probably Ice Block.
No, okay. Yeah. Cone of Cold and a secret.
Actually, no, he's not really in a big threat here to have his block popped. So maybe he could Spellbender to try and protect this Flame Waker from a spell. It's hard to say. Yeah, I think I actually like the Spellbender here because I don't think he should be worried about dying.
Yeah, I guess he just doesn't. It's hard. Because you can't see the hand. Okay, Fandral Teacher once again. This hand is just repeating itself.
Yeah, Innervate, not the best card at the moment.
Yeah.
But Jackpot might be able to just grind out of this game. And if I were One Jack, I would just play the Fandral. You don't want to give Temple Mage one minion to kill every turn. You can't get greedy with Fandral's effect. And if he passes here... That's really slow. Firelance Portal is going to wreck this board.
That's true.
And how does One Jack come back from that? I think this Fandral should have been slammed on the board yesterday. And now he's got two. So now you're just giving Jackpot a turn to draw a second Firelance Portal to deal with it.
I like the Spellbender more than the Mana Worm here. With the portal. Or I guess the Worm could contest to the 2/2. So it's okay.
Yeah, I don't know. I think you can... Yeah, I think Spellbender's pretty good. Ooh, Crazed Worshipper.
That's a good one.
That's a really good one.
Stops the druid from hitting his face. The war. Oh my goodness. He's going to innervate a 10-10 war.
Uprooted and downrooted at the same time. How does that even work?
Oh, perfect timing.
He's in the ground, but he's not in the ground.
How many spells is that? At least 15.
Yeah, but I think you're mana worming and firelance portaling first, the Fandral.
Right. That's pretty good, too.
And trying to chip down that Ancient of War, because that's his last card.
Yeah, but the 10 could go face.
Interesting.
You can't really.
Yeah, he could trade and hero power.
The Crazed Worshipper?
No, I'm sorry. I meant well, the one Jack, his 10-10 could hit the face. But then he does have Ice Block.
Yeah. But I think he's going to be able to kill it next turn regardless.
Oh, yeah.
So, like, if it trades into the 3-6, then Jackpot's going to be able to kill it. I would have liked to see a ping on the Ancient of War. And now Swipe is just going to hit a Spellbender.
I think it's going to... what's he going to swipe here?
He's going to try and swipe the Crazed Worshipper to try and trade into it, I think.
I feel like he should hit the Crazed Worshipper first. And then swipe down the Harrison, but yeah, there's a Spellbender.
Yeah.
But I'm just thinking on the line of the one Jack.
Maybe he realized that it was Spellbender. He knew that it wasn't Counterspell.
Yeah. I think he should have traded first.
Yeah.
Since he wasn't going to swipe it anyways.
Doesn't really matter.
Yeah, it doesn't matter because, like, he doesn't have a Cthulhu. Definitely Fireball here.
That's really good.
And actually, you want to ping it.
Yes.
Don't want
to. He's out of cards. You have plenty of time to play that Cabal Stone. You have an Ice Block up. So the one Jack needs a very good card right now, and Wild Growth is not a very good card right now.
At least you can draw with it.
Yeah, but I mean, he's out of Ancient of Wars. He's out of Arcane Giants.
Oh, another one.
He's got Wild Growth in his deck, apparently. That's all he's got left.
Uh-oh.
Let's see.
Oh, wait. That can take out the worm. Is he going to? Oh, he wants to draw. Draw.
There's Yogg.
It's a showdown. Guys, we have another Yogg versus Yogg once again. And they're both at 12 HP. Jackpot has the Ice Block, though.
Jackpot's cast a lot more spells this game, too.
Yeah. It's kind of scary.
A lot more spells.
And then you got the Vaporize. Oh, goodness.
I don't think the one Jack's... I think you have to Vaporize here because...
Yeah, the Yogg is coming up.
Yeah, if he Yoggs and you're forced to counter Yogg, mm-hmm. you want that all your secrets to be up and that spell... Ugh, I don't think there's any reason to pink face here.
Yeah, you're far from actually killing him. Okay, Hero Power, Innervate, Yogg.
He's got to do it.
He's just actually worried that it might be Mirror Entity.
Wait.
What are you thinking of, TJ?
Why is he... No. What?
What? Oh, it's Counterspell. Okay. He's checking
it. Oh, no, that's good. That's really good. Yeah, that's really good.
That's great. That was really smart.
Yeah.
Because if he... Yeah, it would have cost him.
Because if he had Hero Powered and then Innervated, mm-hmm. and the Counterspell went off, he would have still only have 8 mana.
Yeah, that's why it was really smart. Oh, my gosh.
Oh, no.
Oh. No!
Yogg, what are you doing?
Yogg, what are you doing?
Fist of Draxxus. Oh, at least he hit his opponent's face.
Oh, hey, it's gonna heal him now, right?
Still got
draw, sorry.
Tracking's actually not good because it fatigues him.
Oh, what's the secret? There's two secrets.
But, I mean, he's now at 0 cards left. He has to spend the rest of this game with a Raven Idol.
This is too much.
Inner Rage. Oh my god, Yogg. Oh my god, Yogg.
The wrong minion, Yogg. Seriously. What? Oh my god. Okay.
It is on face again! And he fatigues himself!
Oh my goodness. We never got to see this other Yogg. That is like a really bad Yogg.
Jackpot's like, thank you.
He's like, I didn't have to do anything.
He's like, what a well-fought game. I just played a bunch of spells, removed all his minions, and then my opponent killed himself for me.
It's like, that Yogg was actually his opponents.
The Yogg was actually pretty sick, just in the wrong direction for the one Jack, unfortunately. But really great play from the one Jack. The only criticism I have is that maybe he played a little bit too slow at some of the stages in the game, like not playing the Fandral earlier to actually try and pressure. Forcing Jackpot to have multiple answers instead of just one answer would have been great. But the play at the end there where he played the Innervate first, you know, playing around the possibility of Counterspell, which is the only thing that would have lost him that game. Like, Mirror Entity doesn't matter because he plays Yogg, so Yogg's probably going to clear it.
Right.
And if he had Hero Powered and then Innervate Yogg, then he would have been in a really bad spot. And it was worth it for him to potentially waste the Innervate, since if you play Innervate at 10 mana, you actually don't get any benefit. It was worth it to him to forego the extra one damage and the extra armor for him to be able to play, to for sure play Yogg that turn.
I just remember your reaction. It was the best. I would go back and watch that again just to see your reaction when he innervated first. We were like, wait, what? Because I guess we kind of forgot that there was Counterspell.
I was so focused on the fact that he didn't play the Vaporize.
Yeah.
I didn't even see the other secret that he played.
Yeah. I mean,
I thought it was Spellbender for a second again, and so I was about to say, there's absolutely no reason to innervate first if that's Spellbender, but he didn't know what that secret was, so it's correct and very smart play for him, to be honest.
Yeah, I agree.
To play around the one possibility, because at the end of the day, the risk of not being able to play Yogg that turn is much higher than losing one damage and one armor, which at the end of the day isn't that big of a deal.
Definitely. He made the right play there. I feel like it's also because we've seen at least 100 spells already in this match.
In this match, probably even more.
Yeah, it's nuts.
Than 100 spells.
Tome after tome after tome after tome on both sides.
Yeah, there's been three games so far, and Temple Mage was played three times in those three games.
Yeah.
And in each of the Temple Mage games, there was at least 10 spells played on both sides.
I know.
So that's 50 or 60 spells alone just from those games. And then you count the other three decks that were played in the series, which was two Token Druids and a Dragon Warrior, and a Hybrid Hunter. We're getting probably close to 100, so.
I'm going to be pooped out of Temple Mage at the end of this, and also Token Druids.
It's actually surprising. We've seen a lot of Temple Mage actually played on the stream matches, but Temple Mage isn't actually that high representative of a deck. There was 63 players that brought Mage, and 10 of them were Freeze. Mm-hmm. So it was about 50 players out of 128 who brought Temple Mage, and almost every single match that we featured on stream today has had a Temple Mage. So.
Yeah, it's kind of crazy.
It's a pretty good hand for the one Jack.
Yeah, and Jackpot's got to look for more ramp.
Yeah, really.
I think I would have even thrown out the Living Roots just to find better cards.
Yeah. I mean, if you turn one, I like it better if you're not on the coin. Yeah. Because even if you draw Wild Growth, you can still play Living Roots. Hmm. You can't play Wild Growth in its place. Whereas if you're on the coin, you actually have an opportunity to Wild Growth. So one Jack just going to go ahead and respond with his own Living Roots.
Ooh, wow. Ho-ho! Here we go. Let's
hello. Go.
And yeah, just trade off his little Living Roots. They've served their purpose. Oh no, he's just like, you know what? I'm just going to go face and let the one Jack trade into me instead.
Jackpot asserting his dominance over this game board.
Sometimes I do that too, because I hope that my opponent would trade, but then sometimes they don't and they just deal with it. But I mean, Jackpot's not. He knows that you can't swipe this.
Yeah.
Maybe a Hero Power would be fine, and he's okay with that.
Yeah, because then he's just going to Hero Power back the next turn for himself anyway.
Yeah. He could innervate coin the drink.
Kind of innervate coin nourish for mana.
Yeah, that's actually good too. Because, yeah, if you drink, you have no turn three. It's going to do just what you said, TJ.
Because then he can also hero power down one of these 1-1s, and he rolls into Azure Drake. So he keeps one of his 1-1s alive and rolls into Azure Drake. So.
Yeah.
And he stays a mana ahead, which in this matchup is actually really important, because you get the initiative.
That was actually a good turn for him.
Nice patience on the Raven out from Jackpot. Doesn't really know what he's going to need yet.
Yeah. He can deal with this living root, this sapling with his hero power.
Mm-hmm. Whoa, but one Jack is drawing hot right now. So is Jackpot, though.
Hey, he could get a Wrath and he could innervate.
If he does get a Wrath, that is going to be sick.
Ooh.
Dark Erico is great. Bite, not so much.
I feel like Bite's okay if you tie it up with the hero power and just kill a Fantral or a Teacher.
Yeah. I mean, I think Bite's his only option. I've actually never seen a Golden Savagery before.
Me neither. The Soul of the Forest Golden looks nice.
That's
but
really
this
creepy.
I feel like this is an easy pick for Bite. It helps you get rid of 5 HP minions. Which is kind of hard for Druid, unless you have the Swipe or Feral Rage.
Yeah. But Jackpot's going to be very sad in a moment as Fandral Wrath is going to come out and take out his own Fandral.
It's going to deal 5.
Yep. Behold the Rage of the
Firelands. Behold the Rage of the Firelands.
Yep.
Firelands Portal. Sorry, I don't play well.
Yeah. I think you gotta bite down this Fandral.
I was actually just looking at the swipe. It's not a good swipe.
I mean.
It's so weird. It's not like the best turn, but at least it gets rid of the Fandral. He can actually drop the Arcane Giant here. He can even play Roots if he wants to, then Arcane Giant. But I normally like to save the Roots for, like,
damage.
Yeah.
Trying to spot removal. But he's going for it.
I guess he's just going for it in case he top decks his Power of the Wild.
Yeah.
Unless he has Savage Roar, and that's also what he's doing.
So, Jackpot can try and bait him into a position here where he trades Arcane Giant. If he plays Dark Arakoa and the one Jack trades in the Arcane Giant into the Dark Arakoa, then next turn Jackpot can swipe and Living Roots remove. And also he could swipe Living Roots. If you have 3 mana left, the Arcane Giant would be at 6. And then he could innervate on Arcane Giant. So Dark Arakoa is definitely the right play. Because if he does trade an Arcane Giant, next turn he could swipe Living Roots to clear what's on the board, and then innervate out of Arcane Giant with perfect mana usage.
Oh, what happened to the game?
Whoa!
It's so bright.
I guess we had an issue with Spectator. Hopefully it didn't affect the players, as that was a pretty close game that sort of hinged on the decision that that Jackpot was going to make there with the Dark Arakoa.
Yeah, I agree with that play. It was the best play. Setting up for the perfect swipe. Otherwise, if it wasn't that play, it would have been swiping and then Living Roots and then hero powering it down, which he probably did, which is not that great.
Well, he got slightly punished.
Yeah, he found a way to deal with it.
That hurts.
Yeah, it's actually looking pretty bad for Jackpot right now. Jackpot is wishing he had a mulch in his hand right now. Well, maybe 2 turns ago, at least.
Yeah. But, I mean, that should be game. I don't see any play that Jackpot can make here that would let him survive, because he'd have to clear the Arcane Giant as one Jack has a swipe in his hand. So that means it looks like we're going to game number five here.
Yep. Which was, I felt like it was expected.
Yeah. He's going to try and do his best here, get an Arcane Giant out to challenge, but that's going to be one Jack taking it with the Token Druid.
So the one Jack has his Mage against Jackpot's Druid.
Yep.
It's another Yogg Showdown.
It could be another Yogg Showdown. You can see the one Jack, no emotion. Stone cold killer of Hearthstone players and dreams everywhere.
A lot of the really great Hearthstone players now are like really young. Lots of young up and coming players.
Well, even the two world champions so far both won in their teens. Osaka and Firebat. Both were teenagers at the time of their win. Not both still teenagers. I think Osaka's in his 20s now, but Osaka was 19 when he won, and Firebat was 17 when he won.
Wow. And then now we have the young savage, Amnesiac.
He'll be representing. We also have George C. has a really good chance of making it, because he'll have the Summer Championship as well as Last Call if he doesn't already qualify for the for BlizzCon at the Summer Championships. This will be his second time. He's only 15 as well.
Hot Meowth is also a young one.
Hot Meowth, I think, is like 18 now. But still a teenager.
Right.
A lot of up-and-coming players, a lot of established names are very young. Something about being young. You're not afraid to take risks. And that's in life, and that's in Hearthstone. So they don't have much reserve when they play. They're not afraid of like people's perception of who they are, the way they play, and they're not afraid of sort of making mistakes and learning from the mistakes. Whereas I feel like a lot of older players get caught up in the
overthinking,
or not wanting to look bad and being too prideful and things along those lines. So young players are definitely the way of the future. Both these guys are pretty young. One Jack, you can definitely tell. But time for game number five.
Ooh.
Of the final match of the day. So this will be the final game of the day. Oh, it's actually Hunter.
Oh, it's
deck.
His Hunter.
Yeah, he just won with Druid. That's right.
Oh, okay.
So yeah, it's Druid for Jackpot and the one Jack with the Hunter deck. Weird Hunter deck. It has N'Zoth.
Yeah.
So an interesting choice. Only Death Rattles being Kindly Grandmother and Festive Wolf and Savannah Highmane. With a special shout out to Barnes.
Actually, the Hunter doesn't have a great start here. And the Druid, on the other hand, has a very nice start.
Yeah. Needs a 2-drop here. Doesn't find one.
Still nothing. And hero powering on turn 2 is not what you really want to do as a hunter. The Druid deck, he's got the saplings. Yeah. And those could actually deal with anything, really, that he puts out.
Yeah.
If it's a Huffer. It is a Huffer.
It is a Huffer.
And the one Jack wasn't looking, he wasn't wanting a Huffer. Yeah. You could see his face.
I mean, this will be met with a deadly shot, though. So at least the one Jack has that going for him.
Yeah. He has to get rid of it.
Yeah. Vengeful and the Nourish would just be too big of a deal against the ramp.
Yeah, that's disgusting. you never want a Fandral to nourish. It's kind of like game change. Like, it's just that just sets the game early.
Yeah, they draw 3 cards and they gain 2 mana crystals. So, yep, gonna go ahead and deadly shot. Feel like it's the right choice. There are a lot of big minions in the deck that you want to hit, but I feel like making sure that you don't fall too far behind in the game is more crucial. If one Jack can make it to Savannah Highmane, could be in pretty good shape.
Yeah, I like the Infested Wolf here. Oh.
Violet Teacher, trade.
You think innervate, he's going to swipe?
Swipe. You're clinging on the beast on the board. You're putting a lot of damage on your opponent. Mm-hmm. You're also getting closer to Arcane Giants. The Arcane Giants are going to go down to 8, so you can actually coin out one of the Arcane Giants next turn. So Jackpot off to a great start.
Mm-hmm. Savannah Hymen doesn't look that great right now, but oh, what about Explode? Oh.
Ooh, Unleash.
Unleashed into Kill Command is actually really good.
Still gets to keep a Hound around. The question is, how is he going to deal with a back-to-back Arcane Giants? It's going to be the toughie here.
Can he play both?
No, he can play back-to-back, though.
Well, he could heal with Moonglade. That's a good one. I think it's time for the Savannah Hymen, though. And then you could, like, probably Houndmaster it.
Yeah.
It just contests nicely against the, what is that? 6/5.
The Sideshow Spell Eater?
Sideshow Spell Eater.
I'm pretty sure that's what it's called. It copies your opponent's hero power.
Mm.
But it's very buggy. Half the time it doesn't work. But nobody really plays it anyway. It's a very fringe card.
I guess he could trade or...
Yeah, but Houndmash is going to put a pretty big stop to this. Jackpot is very healthy, though.
Houndmaster into Freezing Trap is okay.
Houndmaster and then trade into the Sideshow Spell Eater and then Freezing Trap is... Mm-hmm. Actually, incredible, because yeah. He didn't actually play the Arcane Giant for that cheap.
Could.
He's going to try and Freezing Trap the Sideshow Spell Eater. That's kind of funny, because yeah. If you play it, it forces your opponent to take Steady Shot, but I don't know if that's a good thing.
Well, I feel like if he Freezing Trapped the Arcane Giant, it's still kind of cheap, right?
Well, it'd be 8 mana, so not really.
I mean, it would be getting
cheaper, but I think this game's going to, like, hit, like, a velocity really quickly. Because the one jack's just getting closer and closer to Nazoth and Call of the Wild. Either or would be huge for this board, whether he draws in one of the Call of the Wilds or Nazoth.
It's actually, this match is pretty close. We can see that one Jack has the board right now.
Just play it again.
I guess, yeah, he's looking for a... Wait, what about Teacher into Raven Idol? Ooh, that's a good one. That's actually really good.
He knows that the one Jack only runs a single copy of Deadly Shot.
Yeah.
So he's investing a lot into this Arcane Giant.
Ooh, but...
If you're old Leoc, this is actually going to be a lot of damage.
Yeah, I like this, and Houndmaster, and... Or actually, he doesn't even need to put Explosive Trap. Houndmaster Hero Power? I like Houndmaster a Hyena. Or he could just set up the... Explosive Trap, so that next turn he could play the bow.
Mm-hmm.
But I feel like it's nice to get every hero power in as much as you can already.
Yeah.
It's a very close game. Yeah. We have like a ton of damage on one side, and then we have this bulky arcane giant as a taunt. On the other end. Ooh, Mulch is pretty okay. He could...
He could
mulch swipe.
And... Yeah.
I feel like he's going to swipe here, maybe? Or...
Swipe only clears off one minion. Swipe takes off the exact amount of power on the board that Wrath does.
Yeah, you're right. Mulch and Wrath is great.
Mulch and Wrath, he can still keep his Arcane Giant alive for another turn. The one thing is that one Jack is out of resources, so he gives him an impactful minion from... Mulch, it's gonna hurt him a lot, but mm-hmm. It's a lot of bad minions in the game, and Arbor Smith is one of those bad minions.
I mean, He could get armor. Where is his Call of the Wild?
Where's his Nuzoth?
Oh, Kill that's actually Command. Pretty good.
I mean, it's
does
okay,
he
but
want to take that to his face with the bow?
I don't think he can afford to. What? He's going to take 8?
Ouch.
I mean, I guess he has the armor smith, but that's a lot of damage to take.
This is nuts. This is so close.
And I mean, the one jack has a lot of good draws still left in his deck. Again,
he
draws. Ooh.
I think he could Wild Growth first.
I think Violet Teacher. Opponent's out of stuff. Get that teacher on the board.
But then if he makes a bunch of tokens, like the hunter just gains armor.
I think it's okay. I think just taking control of the board is what's going to win in the game.
Mm-mm-mm. This is tough, actually. Very, very tough.
She's going to actually copy his hero power.
Oh, that's actually pretty good. And then, now, this is very, very scary. That's 8 kills him next turn.
No, because, oh yeah, because the swipe, you hit 0 health before the armor registers.
Oh, he has to attack with his Howlmaster and...
Yeah, I mean, he can survive.
Hyena. Yeah.
But, I mean, he needs, like, perfect draws for the rest of the game.
This is nuts. He has to trade into it, because that's, like, lethal already. But is he going to sacrifice his armor smith or the hyena? It's a tough call.
Yeah, and he needs to find a way to piece together 18 damage.
Wait,
in 2 turns.
5, 6, 7. Actually, it's already lethal still. No, it's not. It's gonna be 1 off.
Yeah.
Lethal.
Because the armor will bring him up to 8. It's actually gonna keep the armorsmith alive. So.
Yeah, I think that's actually a good play. Oh, that's. All right. Crazy.
Now you just Violet Teacher, Blood Mage, Thaunos, Swipe, Innervate, Hero Power. Actually, maybe he's worried about Call of the Wild. But, I mean, I think that's the best you're going to get.
Oh my gosh, this is so intense.
Give him Violet Teacher, Wild Growth first.
Mm-hmm.
So Violet Teacher, then Wild Growth. And then Blood Mage, Innervate, Swipe. If he doesn't find anything from the Wild Growth that he thinks is good...
Yeah, the fact that the one Jack hasn't drawn Call of the Wild yet is kind of scary. Jackpot knows it's coming any minute, any turn. Oh, that war is going to help, but wait, can he? He can't. No, he can't innervate it right now.
It's hidden right now. It's hiding behind a white glow.
But yes, it is a war. Oh my goodness. Is he going to swipe? The armor smith.
I don't get why he wouldn't Blood Mage swipe. I mean, you push almost the exact amount of damage, you just kill the Knife Drugger. So now if he top decks Unleash the Hounds or Call the Wild, he gets 3 juggles also.
That's true. Oh, wow.
Yeah. Well, that'll be game.
3.
Jackpot has seen the other 2 traps, and he knows the deck list, so he should know that one Jack only runs 1 copy of Freezing, 1 copy of Explosives, 1 copy of Snake.
Yeah, he's not going to hit that. That's nuts. The one Jack didn't get a single Call of the Wild.
Orden is off, yeah. And he's going to try and bluff it here, I guess, but Jackpot should know exactly what this is if he was paying attention.
Hey, he has 2 spells, huh? Oh, it's explosive.
Oh, yeah, it's already as explosive.
Yeah.
Oh, Whisper of the Old Gods is going to end the game.
Wow, people are getting hyped downstairs. Oh my gosh.
Ah!
Oh, my gosh.
That was very scary.
Wow.
I forgot he had the second trap up. But Whisper of the Old Gods is going to end the game in Jackpot.
Oh, wow. That was it.
Gonna be moving on to the round of 8.
Can't believe we forgot about the explosive. It was
what was hidden from us for so long.
Exactly, yeah. You know, and actually, like, the bar at the top kind of hides it a bit. Yeah.
But a crazy series, very back and forth, a lot of close matches. These guys, almost identical deck lists across the board. Both have the Hunter list, the only one that sort of deviates, but it was banned on the other side. And, you know, a tough fought series for the one Jack, but he'll have to fight his way through the lower bracket now.
That's a tough one. You can see the look on the one Jack's face. It was a very tough defeat.
Yeah. But a fun series nonetheless. We got to see a couple Yogs. We got to see probably like, give or take, about 50 Cabal Tomes. Might be a little off on the mat there, but roughly that amount. And looking forward to seeing Jackpot play tomorrow. He had a really interesting style of play where, you know, some games he would play very aggressive and some games he would play very passive. Mm-hmm. But ultimately it ended up working out for him.
Right.
And he got it done with the Druid in the last game.
It's not the end of the road for the Yuan Jack. He still has lower brackets, so maybe he can do well in there.
So upper bracket round of 16, we'll put him in the lower bracket round of 32, I believe, which means he'll have to win 1, 2, 3, 4 matches in a row to secure himself in the top 8, where Jackpot only has to win 1 now to secure himself in the top 8 for the whole tournament, which puts him in the prize money.
A good place to be.
Yeah, and Hearthstone Championship Tour points, but they don't mean anything for any players here anymore, as I believe both the players that had implications are dropped out. Maybe
not,
though.
Icho was the last one I casted. He goes by the name Throne?
Yeah.
Yeah, he's still in.
He's still in. Okay.
So yeah, we're going to have a look at these replays.
Yeah.
There was a ton of Yogs.
Yeah. So we're going to take a look at a clip from game number 4, the 10th tome that took place from the Babbling Book, and this is the 11th tome that is also from the same game, and a ridiculous amount of spells cast. Oh, there's number 12.
I think they're just going to show us how many tomes there
were. Wait, that was the same tome. They cheated.
Was it?
Showed the same tome twice. Can't do that.
I was actually starting to count.
Yeah, and this is where the one Jack Firelands portals his face twice.
Ouch.
Into a fan of knives for a self-kill fatigue, and one Jack's like, yep, that's the risk you take when you put Yogg-Saron in your deck. And we also have a clip from the last game. He had Explosive Trap and Snake Trap up, needed exactly Whispers of the Old Gods to find lethal in the situation. I guess Swipe would have done it too. Bite would have done it. Mark of Nature would have done it.
That's true.
Even Mark of the Wild would have done it because he could have put it on his Volateacher and then Hero Powered.
Uh-huh.
So lots of cards to find for lethal, but he does it with the Wisps of the Old Gods.
It's actually a really good card, yeah, that he needed. I'm sure he knew also that it was explosive. Like, he knows the secrets.
Well, yeah, he knew the deck. So he saw a Freezing Trap being played already. He knew that there was one of each of Freezing, Explosive, and Snake.
Yep.
So he knew exactly what it was. But that's it for day one. Let's go ahead and take a look at what we're going to be seeing tomorrow on day number 2 of the Hearthstone Thailand Major. We're going to be playing through the upper bracket again. And tomorrow's where it all comes to a close. It was actually pretty chaotic today.
Yeah.
But you can see tomorrow we're going to start with the round of 8 upper bracket. And then towards the end of the day, we're going to head down to the lower bracket with the lower bracket semifinals and lower bracket finals, until we have our 2 grand finalists. And then we'll crown another Southeast Asia major champion here in Thailand. Cyanface won the Singapore major just a few months back. And he was a local player to Singapore. So maybe we'll get to see a Thai player.
Actually, he's in this tournament.
He is.
But I'm not sure. He might be in the lower. Right?
He was actually in the upper bracket the last time I checked.
Okay.
That was right before I casted this match. So, you know, he could have lost the following match after that. I don't want to jinx it if he's still playing right now. But, yeah, it was, so maybe we'll see a Thai player win. There's a lot of Thai players still left in the tournament.
Yeah. Isn't Leda still in?
Yeah.
He's actually the Southeast Asia Summer Preliminaries winner.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, so he'll be representing Southeast Asia at the Asia Pacific Championship. So maybe he'll take another tournament.
You'll see him there.
I will. But that's going to do it for us here at the Hearthstone Thailand Major. We will return tomorrow, same time, same place. So make sure you guys tune in, and that's going to be fantastic. We're going to crown a champion tomorrow. So for myself and Pather and all the other casters, as well as the entire production crew, thank you guys for watching, and we'll see you tomorrow.